Good morning. How are y'all doing this morning? I'm doing well. Thank you, Paul, for answering me. This morning's scripture reading will be Philippians 2, 5 through 11. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who through he was in the form of God, did not equally with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in his life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to him pour. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see his loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that he is leading through all the stormy blast. the day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to him part. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal alleluias to Jesus Christ the King. The hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. Another is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to him part. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
Good morning, church. So we're going to do things a little different this morning. It's going to be different in that our service is going to be primarily about singing songs of praise and gratitude to God. We're doing it differently this morning because 2,000 years ago on a Sunday very similar to the Sunday we have right now, a miracle took place. A miracle that thousands and millions of people around the world are going to gather together today to celebrate. A miracle that we here at the Church of Christ celebrate every time we take of communion. We celebrate it every Sunday. It is a miracle worthy of celebrating because it's the miracle of an empty tomb, a miracle of the empty tomb. And so today we're going to sing songs to him, songs of gratitude, songs of praise, songs of reverence. Because that is just one of many ways that we have been blessed, that we have been taught, in order to say thank you to a God worthy of our thanks. Consider with me for just a moment two passages, Colossians 3:16 and Psalms 96. We'll start with 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And then Psalm 96. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord and praise his name. Proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all people. For great is the Lord, and he is most worthy of praise. And so this morning, may we lift up our hearts and our souls in song. May we bring him the praise that he is worthy of and the gratitude of our hearts.
Let's pray. Dear Father God, we thank you for all the blessings you've given us. We know you are the Alpha, the Omega, the person we come to for all our problems, our issues, and for everything that you've done for us. Lord, we ask you to be with us today, that we continue to worship you, that we continue to sing praises to you. We might not be worthy of your greatness, but we will not be silenced. We will give you praise. And we love you. Please forgive us as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. These things we pray through your Son, Jesus. Amen.
way did my Savior come to earth and to the humble go? Why did he choose a lowly birth? Because he loved me so. Comes, I'll sing his praise, and then to glory go, and reign with him through endless days, because he loved me so. Glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Lord Jehovah reigns in majesty. We will bow before his throne. We will worship him in righteousness. We will worship him alone. He is Lord of heaven, Lord of earth. He is Lord of all who live. He is Lord above the universe. All praise to him give. Hallelujah to the King of Kings. Hallelujah to the Jesus is Lord, my Redeemer. How he loves me, how I love him. He is risen, he is coming. Lord, come quickly. Everything to
24. Luke chapter 24. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices that they had prepared and they went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. When they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen." Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary, the mother of James, they went to the tomb to administer to the body of their beloved Jesus. And I want us to imagine for just a second what must have been on their hearts and on their minds as they got up early that morning to walk to that tomb. Remembering that a few days prior, they had watched that Jesus that they loved, admired, revered, and trusted so very much suffer such a grisly death. They didn't just watch him die, they watched him suffer. They saw the miracle that occurred when he finally gave up his spirit. They saw him lose his dignity while hanging on the cross before crowds shouting to have him crucified, before crowds that were mocking him, spitting on him, and doing all manner of disrespectful things. As they walked to that tomb, imagine the sorrow that must have been in their hearts that morning. They walked to that tomb to add perfumes to the body of the man that they loved most, to mourn their loss. It had to have been hard. And then they get there, and it's open. At that point, I imagine they were probably pretty confused. And then they go in, and they find that Jesus is missing, and they must have been even more confused, if not a little scared. And then before them appear two angels who ask them what I consider to be one of the most wondrous questions ever asked. It's a beautiful question. I have a hard time reading this passage, to be honest, without getting tearful myself. He says, "Why do you seek the living with the dead? He's not here. Jesus has risen." And in that moment, those ladies must have finally understood. They must have finally realized what Jesus was saying would happen after he passed. Imagine how they felt in that moment. It should be very similar to how we feel every time we gather together on Sunday morning to worship him. Overjoyed, filled with hope, bursting to the brim with gladness in their hearts. And that's why today we're singing. That's why today we are rejoicing. That's why today is a day worthy of joy. That's why every day is a day worthy of singing, rejoicing, and joy. As we continue our service this morning, our worship this morning, let us try to feel the joy that those ladies felt that morning.
Thankful Easter prayer. Lord God, you love this world so much that you gave your one and only Son that we may be all called your children. Lord, help us live in the gladness and the grace of Easter Sunday every day.
Let us stand.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. When the Savior shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder. When the roll is caught up yonder, I'll be there. On that bright cloud
this morning when the dead in Christ shall rise and the glory of his resurrection share. When the chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Oh, let us lay before the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all our life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Please be seated. Number 235. Let all that is within me. I gave him a little scare this morning already.
Let all that is within me cry worthy. Let all that is within me cry worthy. Worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Let all that is within me cry risen.
Slain. Number 269, Thomas song.
Jesus, you were all to me. Why did you die on Calvary? O Lamb of God, I fail to see how this could be part of the plan. They say that you're alive again, but I saw death in every sin reach out to claim their darkest win. How could this be part of the plan? If I could only hold your hand and touch the scars when nails were driven, I would need to feel your side where holy flesh my spear was riven. Then I believe, only then I believe, your cruel death was part of a heavenly plan. Holy presence, holy face, a vision filling time and space. Your nearness makes my spirit raise. Could this be part of the plan? I see the wounds that cause the cry from heaven's ocean, earth, and sky. When people watch the Savior die, could this be part of the plan? Reaching out to hold your hand and touch the scars where nails were driven. Coming near, I feel your side where holy flesh my spirit was riven. Now I believe, Jesus, now I believe. Your cruel death was part of the heavenly plan.
John chapter 20, verse 24 through 31, if you want to follow along. Now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." And then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. But blessed are those who have not seen and yet still believe." You see, Thomas was also struggling. He had gone through what those ladies had gone through. He had watched his mentor die a horrific death. And in his mourning, he found it difficult to accept that Jesus could have possibly come back. The plan had confused him. He didn't understand. But when the truth was finally revealed to Thomas, what does he do? You can see him rejoice. He says, "My Lord and my God." And there's an exclamation point there. He's exclaiming this. He's excited about this. He loves this. He's filled with hope again. So he utters a statement not just of reverence and joy, but a statement that every single one of us is wearing on our hearts this morning. A statement of acknowledging that Jesus is Lord, that he is God, that he is our master, our hope, and that he was the plan all along. Thomas was blessed because he got to walk with and talk with Christ on an earthly plane. Yet Jesus tells us we're going to be blessed too, that we are blessed, perhaps more than Thomas, because we believe even though we haven't seen. And that is true faith in and of itself. So like Thomas, may we continue to revere and praise God this morning with remarks about how he is our Lord and our God.
Let's pray. Our dear glorious God above, we gather together every first day of the week to glorify you, today being a special day, Resurrection Sunday. We are truly thankful that you gave your Son to the cross so that we may be called children of yours. This can only be a godly move. As awful as the death was, the result that we are children of yours. Through Jesus we pray. Amen.
Let
Let God arise, let his enemies be scattered. Let God arise, let his enemies be scattered. Let God arise, let his enemies be scattered. Let God arise. Our God arose, and his enemies were scattered. Our God arose, and his enemies were scattered. Our God arose, let his enemies were scattered. Our God arose. He is Lord, he is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. He's our King, he's our King. He is reigning over us, and he's our King. We adore and praise and lift up our voice to Jesus Christ, our King. Your only Son, no sin to hide, but you have sent him from your side to walk upon this guilty side and to become the
I saw a tweet yesterday I'd like to share with you. It said, "Yes, Sunday's coming, but we have need of Saturday. Do not rush it. Feel the helplessness and horror. Imagine the pictures that they could not get out of their head. There's nothing you can do. No work. You're forced into Sabbath, suspended in stillness between what was and what will be." And they gave me a perspective that I hadn't really thought about before, the helplessness between Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday, the witnessing the horrific death of Jesus and just sitting and waiting for Sunday to come. The writer in Hebrews talked about the hopelessness before Christ's death. In Hebrews chapter 10, starting in verse 1, he said, "For the law, since it has only a shadow of good things to come and not the form of the things itself, can never by the same sacrifices they offer continually every year make those who approach perfect. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered? Because the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have had consciousness of sins. But in those sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins." And later in verse 10, he says, by this will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all time. Every Sunday we come together and we take the Lord's Supper, remembering Christ's death. But I think there's value in remembering what it was like before that. There's value in remembering the horrors that Christ went through and the stillness and the sadness that came on Saturday. And then the hope that we have, so that we never have to feel that hopelessness. We never have to feel that hard because Christ overcame death, because he overcame the grave. And as we take of the bread, which represents Christ's body, which hung on the cross, and his blood, which was shed for us, we never have to feel the horrors that those who witness Christ's death feel. We never have to feel the hopelessness of our sins not being forgiven. So as we take of the Lord's Supper, let us focus our minds on that and remember Christ's death and his resurrection. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we'd like to thank you again so much for allowing us to worship you this morning, Lord, as we take of the bread, which again represents Christ's body, which hung on the cross for our sins. Lord, we ask you to help us to focus our minds on that great sacrifice you made by sending your son to go through such a horrific and gruesome death for us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Lord, as we take of the cup, which represents Christ's blood, which was shed on the cross for our sins, Lord, we ask you to help us to focus our minds in remembrance of his death and what it has done for us, how the blood can make us whole again. Lord, we thank you so much for that. We ask you to help us remember that and take of it in a manner that's pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So this morning we've spent most of our service singing songs of praise and worship towards God. Something that we need to do on a continual basis. Something that we do every Sunday, but we should also probably take time throughout the week to do it as well. If not with our lips, then certainly with our hearts and our prayers. This morning we have given God the glory that is due to him, the praise that is due to him. And I hope that everybody here benefited from that opportunity, from this service that we've had. Because we do serve a mighty God, don't we? We serve a God who, when his time came, went willingly to the cross. That's cause for joy, too, right there. A God who willingly died for us. And when that God died, you can read in Matthew what happened as he cries out. The earth shakes, the curtain around the temple shatters, it shreds, the sky goes dark, the earth cries out. And as he is raised a few days later, you can hear the rejoicing that took place. We serve a mighty, mighty God. If there's something on your hearts or on your minds this morning, now would be a great time to come forward. You can get it off your chest. You can share it with the elders or whoever you want to. And just know that there's always a chance to reconnect if you feel like you've fallen away or to rebond with that mighty God. He's always there. He's always willing. He's gone through so much for us. If there's something you feel you need to address this morning or you're ready to commit your life to him through baptism, feel free to do so as we close out our worship service.
Let's stand and sing. There is beyond the azure blue a God concealed from human sight.